A lot of people have been asking me about the four ashramas as they're understood in the wisdom traditions of the East, particularly in India and in the Vedantic tradition. So here are the four ashramas. Ashrama means a place to rest in, a place where we rest. And when we rest, we have creative intelligence to manifest our destiny in a very conscious way. So the first ashrama is the first 25 years of life, and I've been there, done that. It's called education. The second ashrama is or ashram is also correct, is fame and fortune. And I can say I've been there, done that as well. The third ashrama, which is also the second ashrama or ashram, is 25 years to 50 years. And then from the age of 50 years to 75 years, your main activity is giving back. And I've been doing that, I think, through the Chopra Foundation, Seva.love, Love in Action. And all the programs that are coming from neveralone.love and more. So I think I can say I've been there, done that. I've just entered the fourth ashram, which is 75 years onward, hopefully beyond 100, but that's also karma. Although we know a lot about longevity also today. So the fourth ashram is for self-realization and the awakening to reality, awakening to reality. So it's also called freedom. It's also called moksha, as there are many other terms, but it means a total awakening from the conditioned mind. Because once we are operating from the level of the conditioned mind, then we are immersed in a collective dreamscape. And that collective dreamscape is the dreamscape that humans have constructed by giving words to describe experiences, by giving words to describe experiences. So I shall share with you right now some of the roadmaps to that liberation, freedom from the conditioned mind, and also why that could be a good idea. Okay. So I started by saying we give words to experiences. But before I go there, I like to share my favorite quotes in this exploration. The first one from Wittgenstein, the German philosopher, who said, "Our life is a dream. We are asleep, but once in a while, we wake up enough to know that we are dreaming. Wake up enough to know that we are dreaming. We are awake, the awakened being, the dreamer that is dreaming." Two dreams. One is mind and body, and the other is the world. They go together. So waking up from that, realizing that everyday reality is a lucid dream in a vivid now. So what is the advantage of that? Okay, first let's go to what has been recently called the direct method. So here is something I'm holding in my hand. And you would call it a coffee cup, or I would too. And then this I would call a hand. This I would call a waistcoat, a shirt, spectacles, nose, hair, body. That's what I'm thinking somewhere here, maybe. I would call, a brain, etc., etc. So those are names for an experience. Before you can name something as a coffee cup out there, or here, which is also somewhere out there. Before you name something, it is a modality of experience. So this, for example, is known, has experience, is known and experienced through touch, texture, through taste and smell, fragrance and flavor, through sound, and through color and form, color, shape, and form. What we call the five senses, sound, touch, sight, taste, and smell, is what this coffee cup is made of. It is made of modalities of experiences. But once we name it, it's a coffee cup. It's a construction. It's a human construct for the experience, which is a combination of modalities of experience. Then you say, where is this experience happening? And it's, you know, if you reflect on that, you'll see that this experience can only happen. There is no taste, there's no texture, there is no sound, there is no color, there's no shape. Nothing of the sort in the brain, or actually anywhere in the world. Color doesn't have a presence in the world, nor does fragrance have a presence in the world, nor does flavor, nor does texture, nor does color or brightness or shape have a presence in the world. They only exist in awareness. Please reflect on this. Nothing that you see, touch, taste, smell actually exists in the physical world. And that's why some of the greatest Vedantists have said, if you can see it, touch it, taste it, smell it, think about it, conceptualize it, imagine it, name it, it's not real. It's a passing fluctuation of consciousness as its activity, which we call perception. And as I've said innumerable times, perception is a learned phenomenon and is species and culture specific. In other words, the whole thing is an ungraspable, uncatchable, ephemeral, transient dream. The Buddha said that. And so that you trace back these modalities of experience to their source. What is sound at the source? And what is it? It's a particular frequency or vibration of consciousness. What is color at its source, or shape or form? A particular frequency of consciousness at its source. So too, fragrance and odor and everything that we call the five senses. And then as soon as we name it, then it acquires a history, it acquires context and meaning, and it becomes an object, including our own physical body. It's interesting that I'm using my mind to share with you that the mind is unreliable, because the mind is interpreting perceptions which are species specific, which are transient, which are its own activities. The mind is interpreting them as the physical world, including the physical body. And this physical world and physical body is constantly changing, Only the awareness from which it is changing remains a constant, in that it keeps bubbling with change, like the surface of the ocean, and the bottom of the ocean is always silent, as a metaphor. So when we trace back every experience to its source, we end up with something which is not a thing. It is infinite possibilities. It's infinite correlation. It's infinite creativity. It's infinite self-regulation. It's infinite self-organization. It's infinite ideas. It's infinite perceptions. That which is formless, being infinite, is differentiating, is becoming the one, is becoming the many, innumerable, almost infinite many. So the consciousness is infinite, and its potentialities for manifestation are also infinite through biological organisms, which in turn are instruments of experience, although the biological organism is also an experience in awareness. Reality is not only mysterious, more mysterious than we think, it's more mysterious than we can think. So the potentialities of infinite awareness are infinite manifestations. And we are that. Thou art that. Tattvamasi. Aham Brahmasmi. I am the universe. So what is the advantage to this awakening? The advantage to this awakening is that you experience everyday reality. Everything that I'm experiencing right now. Everything, this room, that mountain, that landscape, that seascape, that skyscape, everything that I'm experiencing is a lucid dream in a vivid now, in a vivid now, a lucid dream in a vivid now. And so what's the advantage of being in a lucid dream? Well, once you're in lucid dream, you can direct it. You can be its director, producer, hero, villain, by making conscious choices, by practicing metacognition, by being an observer to so-called outside and inside reality. Outside and inside are both contained here in the Akashic field as infinite possibilities, constantly bubbling, because, you know, it is the nature of consciousness to be conscious. It is the nature of the experiencer to manifest in the experiencing and the experience itself. And this is moksha. This is freedom to upgrade or dream the lucid dream of your choice. Now, many people say that once this liberation occurs, and actually a lot of spiritual traditions say, you don't have to recycle or reincarnate. You're free from suffering, free from all this melodrama, and that you are in the timeless, eternal now. Yes, but, you know, even the timeless, eternal now is unstable. It's constantly bubbling. It's the nature of consciousness to be conscious. So when we wake up, then we know the lucid dream for what it is. And the lucid dream contains the body mind. And if we are the infinite source that is differentiating as all body minds and their experiences, there's something there. There's something there. It's the multiverse. In its all its potentialities, and you are at the source of it. So I'll end with the quote from Buddha, my favorite quote also, other than Wittgenstein. This lifetime of ours is transient as autumn clouds. To watch the birth and death of beings is like looking at a dance. A lifetime is like a flash of lightning in the sky, rushing by like a torrent down a steep mountain. No lifetime, it doesn't matter. 50 years, 100 years, 150 years, 5 years. A dream is a dream. And that which is the awakened one is the source of infinite dreams in manifestation. Okay, I don't know if that was helpful, but think about it.